Good evening, dear seniors, my friends and colleagues. Today I'm going to discuss about the management of dengue. I thank all the IAP Malanad members for giving me this opportunity to talk on this topic. I also want to thank Shija Madam who guided me at many occasions during this talk. Also, I remember with gratitude my interns, Dr. Janet and Dr. Harita, who has helped me with the preparation of the slides. So let me start with the talk. So, in this talk, I'll be discussing a bit about etiology, pathophysiology, clinical features, management, and prevention. So, coming to the etiology, as you all know, the etiology is dengue virus, which are of four serotypes, that is dengue virus 1, 2, 3, or 4. They are arboviruses belonging to the family Flaviviridae. They are transmitted by the bite of infected female Aedes mosquitoes, which can be either Aedes aegypti or Aedes albopticus. This is the Aedes aegypti, the black one, and this one is the Aedes albopticus, which is found to cause all this Hawaiian epidemics in 2001 and in 2015. They transmit the infection by through humans through bites. And a point to note here is these mosquitoes, once they are infectious, they remain infectious throughout their life. That is why we have to take adequate measures to contain or to kill these mosquitoes, either by using mosquito nets or larvicides and all those things. And they also transmit the infection to their offsprings. That is, transoviral transmission is noted. So that is also very dangerous because an infected mosquitoes can transmit the infection to the offsprings. So coming to the pathogenesis, the exact pathogenesis of dengue is not fully understood, but the main thing is not other than capillary endothelial damage. There is direct invasion of the capillary endothelium by the virus. There is also rapid activation of the complement system, the production of lot and lots of cytokines. There is this antigen antibody reaction, which is actually causing the endothelial damage. Once capillary endothelial damage has happened, what happens that there is the leak. Leak will go and cause a hemoconcentration, hypovolemia, shock, metabolic acidosis, etc. Now, does dengue infection with one serotype provide cross protection against the other serotypes? No. Dengue, once infected, it will not provide cross protection against the other serotypes. But same serotype, yes, it will be protective. But suppose the patient is getting infected first time with dengue virus 1 and the second time with another dengue virus of maybe serotype 4 or 3 or whatever, this infection tends to be more severe. Why is it so? As you can see from the image, the first time where dengue virus primary infection is this one, the cell, you can see the virus is engulfed and the T cells are stimulated to produce cytokines. B cells produce antibodies. This antigen antibody complex is formed, which is engulfed by the macrophages. The virus is killed and the infection is contained. Whereas when the second virus infection happens, there is an early stimulation of the memory cells leading to the production of the antibodies. But these antibodies are said to be infection enhancing because they bind to the virions, but they do not neutralize it. So these antibodies are less effective in binding also. Once they bind, it is not fully bound. Okay, you can make out from the image. So these antibodies bind to the virions, but they do not neutralize it. So what happens? The infection tend to be more severe because there are more viruses, virions are formed, more cytokines are released, more endothelial damage, and this infection tend to be more severe. Coming to the clinical manifestations, the incubation period is about 3 to 7 days. The infants and young children tend to present with undifferentiated febrile illness. Classic presentation is seen in older children, adolescents, and adults. Place classification by the severity, we can divide as dengue without warning signs, or the dengue with warning signs, and severe dengue. We will be discussing in detail about these in coming slides. Another way of classification is mild, moderate, and severe. Mild means undifferentiated fever. Moderate is dengue with warning signs, or those children having dengue with comorbidities, like, for example, heart disease, liver disease, immunodeficiencies, etc. Coming to the severe dengue. Severe dengue means so much of capillary leading on to a respiratory distress, shock, there is hemorrhage, there is extended dengue syndrome or severe organ involvement. The clinical spectrum of dengue says that only 10% are symptomatic dengue. Of the 10%, 50% will be as undifferentiated fever, 40% will come as dengue fever. Around 10% will present as dengue hemorrhagic fever, with only 1% as dengue shock syndrome. This is precisely this area, that is this DHF, DS and all, we have to be very careful here, because the child will go on to the complications. Coming to clinical criteria, suspect dengue fever if the fever is there for around 2 to 7 days duration with two or more of the following, which includes headache, retroorbital pain, myalgia, arthralgia, rash, hemorrhagic manifestations, leukopenia like TCs less than 5,000, platelets less than 1.5 lakhs, or hemoconcentration as evidenced by slightly discomfort. So rising hematocrit by more than 10 to 15%. This is the first part, okay, where there is, it can be a lab proven dengue or it can be a probable dengue. Now, there is something called a dengue hemorrhagic fever, where there is a clinical criteria of dengue fever plus hemorrhagic manifestations as evidenced by positive tourniquet test. I take a minute here to explain about this tourniquet test. That is because when you inflate the cuff between the systolic and the diastolic BP, keep it for 5 minutes, and you count the number of PTK which are actually developed in a 1 square inch below the elbow. Okay, if there are more than 10, it is taken as positive tourniquet test. It is seen in almost more than 50% of the cases. They are also seen as PTK, ecchymosis or purpura. There can be bleeding from mucosa, GIT, injection sites and other sites. So in the case of dengue hemorrhage fever, we'll have criteria for dengue fever. There is hemorrhagic tendencies. There is thrombocytopenia of less than 1 lakh. Plus evidence of capillary leak as evidenced by a rise in average hematocrit. There is a leak, so hemoconcentration. So there is a rise in hematocrit. The leak is causing a pleural effusion or ascites. There is a gallbladder edema as evidenced by the ultrasound. From the ultrasound, this actually, we can, some terminology is there called focus, that is point of care ultrasound. As you can see, gallbladder edema or hypoproteinemia with a serum albumin less than 3.5 gram per deciliter. Coming to dengue with warning signs. Intense abdominal pain or tenderness. That means a child is presenting intense abdominal pain, that is because of the rapid accumulation of fluid in the pararenal and the perirenal areas. Also is splanchnic vasoconstrictions because of the thing, capillary leaks. Then, or the child is presenting with vomiting at least 3 per hour or at least 4 to 6 episodes of vomiting per 6 hours. Or there is clinical fluid accumulation, that is either ascites or pleural effusion. There is a mucosal bleed. There is lethargy. Well, lethargy is because of cerebral hyperperfusion. There is hepatomegaly more than 2 centimeters. There is raised PCV with decrease in platelet count. So the previous image, this is what we had discussed actually. Second part of it, there is dengue with warning signs. Coming to severe dengue, that is the third section of this. Severe dengue is defined as dengue when there is a capillary leakage leading on to shock or severe respiratory distress. There is a clinically significant bleed, or there is severe organ involvement as evidenced by hepatic enzyme AST or ALT more than 1000, or there is a myocarditis, or there is encephalopathy, etc. Here, dengue shock. In severe, I told you there is capillary leak leading on to shock. How can you identify the shock? Shock means all the criteria for DHF will be present, plus the pulse will be rapid and weak. There will be narrow pulse pressure. Pulse pressure is actually the difference between the systolic and the diastolic BP. So that is less than 20 millimeter. There is hypotension, defined as the BP less than 5th centile for that age. There is cold, clammy skin or prolonged CFT. So that is why when a patient of dengue comes to you, at least take and hold the hand of the baby, what all things you can understand. You'll get the pulse, whether rapid or weak. We will be able to see whether the skin is cold or clammy. We can even check our CFT, then go for a BP check. We'll find out whether there is a hypotension first, then also find out what is the pulse pressure. So make it a point to record the pulse pressure in the monitoring chart always. Then there is another terminology called expanded dengue syndrome. That is a dengue involving other organs like CNS, kidney, liver, heart, lung, etc. This tend to have a little protracted course. This can be a mild or a severe organ involvement. And this may be seen not only in severe forms like dengue hemorrhagic fever, but also in dengue fever. All the dengue passes through three phases. That is a febrile phase, which is for 1 to 3 days. Then there is a critical phase, 3 to 6 days. And then there is a convalescent phase, which is around 4 to 7 days. Why we have to be worried here is the complications which is happening in different phases are different. So we have to identify when a patient comes to us, whether the patient is in febrile phase or a critical phase or in a convalescent phase, to decide upon our management. So this is a causes, it can be febrile. So if you see this image, the first part is the febrile phase. The child is having so much of temperature. Slowly it comes down and tend to have a biphasic form. That is a small spike maybe there during the critical phase. Then it settles down. So this is the temperature pattern. So if you can see what is the problem in the second part, that is the febrile phase. Febrile phase, the problem is the dehydration. Whereas in the critical phase, there is so capillary leak has started. There will be shock. There will be bleeding. And finally, in the convalescent phase, all the fluid which have actually leaked out into the extravascular space will be coming back to the interstitium. Will be coming to the intravascular space, leading on to a resorption, reabsorption, and later fluid overload. So here we have to be careful, because if you overdo with the fluids, what happens? All these fluids will come back to the intravascular space, will go, the patient will have pulmonary edema and other complications. Coming to the lab changes, this bold line is the hematocrit. You can see the hematocrit rises in the critical phase. But it's better to have a baseline hematocrit in the febrile phase so that we'll be able to identify whether the how much is the rise in the critical phase. And another thing to note here is the platelets that will drop in the critical phase, not in the febrile phase. So don't be happy if you get a child day two of fever, you do a platelet is relaxed. Don't be happy. It is going to drop in the critical phase. And the convulsion slowly it will rise. But always the platelet rise will be slightly slower than the rise of the TC. Now, coming to the serology and the virological thing, at the first, the febrile phase, it is a viremia, that is our NS1 antigen we will be getting. Later, once towards around 4th to 5th day, IgM starts coming, and it around 99% will come by around day 10 of fever, but most 70 to 80% will have IgM by around 5th day of fever. Then later IgG starts, but this IgG will persist at a low titer for lifelong. The same image I put it. Now, why I put this slide is we have to know the interpretation. Now we are doing all this CAR test and all this. We have to know how to interpret. Let me discuss it one by one. NS1 antigen is positive, but both are negative. Once you see this IgG negative, we can be sure that it is not a previous infection. It is a first time infection. And IgM has not developed. So definitely this fever has the duration will be less than 6 days. Suppose some children will get NS1 antigen and IgM positive. Both will be there. But IgG is negative. So we can be sure that it is a first time infection. It is not, there is no previous infection. It's a first time infection. Both have come. Still in some cases by fourth renal it will come. So again fever less than 5 days only, because our antigen has not disappeared. We get another scenario when NS1 antigen is negative, but IgM only is positive. This is again, IgG is negative. So again, it is a first time infection, but please note, NS1 antigen have disappeared because 5 to 6 days would have got over. This is a first time infection more than 6 days. Now, another scenario when there is only IgG positivity. So there is no current infection. The child is having a previous infection titer. You may be getting this result. You may be investigating the child for another episode of fever. You may get this result. Do you have to consider this as dengue? No, it is only a previous infection. This is not a second infection. Suppose you get a result like this with IgG positive and NS1 antigen positive. Here we have to know this is a second infection. There is a fever, and with the second infection, is less than 6 days because our NS1 antigen is there. Even once the IgM start developing, it may be slightly more than 6 days also with a evidence of past infection. Now let us discuss the management in a case-based approach. So 4-year-old child brought to OPD with today fever for 2 days. Headache, myalgia, rash with stable vital signs and good urine output. Chronic test negative. NS1 antigen positive, IgM negative, IgG negative. IgG negative, so previous infection ruled out. So this is the first time infection. Because NS1 antigen only is positive, it may be that we have done a test early in the course of the disease that maybe the fever is less than 6 days. See, what is this? So this is none other than a dengue fever because all the stable vital signs, good urine output, no other warning signs are mentioned. So this is a case of dengue fever without warning signs. Which phase is the child in now? The fever is only 2 days. So the child is in the febrile phase. So what are the investigation we need to send? If you need to really send an investigation, that is at least have a hemoglobin or an PCV. That is for a baseline thing we can have. PCVs, if you don't have facilities or we don't have to do our PCV, no need. PCV is nothing but hemoglobin into 3. So what is the management? Okay. So what is the management? It is fluids, but oral fluids. Encourage the mother to give more and more oral fluids, but electrolyte-rich fluids like ORS or like kanji water, etc. Otherwise, what will happen if you encourage the child to drink more and more only plain water? There is a chance of hypertonic solution. So what happens? The fluid may leak out. So there is a chance of hyponatremia. So no need. Try to give electrolyte-rich solution. And paracetamol, if you are giving over a lower dose of 10 mg per kg, 6th hourly. Please avoid giving brufen and other things. Later next day, child was brought to casualty with complaints of less oral intake and urine output. Now this is the stage, the oral intake is not there, the parents are apprehensive. What can we do? Here we may have to start on IV fluids. So what fluids and how much? IV fluids, please note the child is still in the febrile phase. No need to consider shock and all. The child is having to start the child on 1.5 ml per kg per hour. This is the fluid requirement. As against the 4 ml per kg per hour and hour and all, which you used to start. But this is the requirement in the febrile phase, which is 1.5 ml per kg per hour. What fluid? Please start on dextrose normal saline, that is DNS. We are going to start maintenance, but always with DNS. Resuscitation, we use normal saline or ringer lactate. And always keep an eye on the urine output, 1 ml per kg per hour. WHO says 0.5 ml per kg per hour, but SAT protocol and the protocol from Thailand, they all say as 1 ml per kg per hour. And keep an eye on the urine output and vitals. Also educate the mother regarding our warning signs, which we had discussed initially. What were the warning signs? Or intense abdominal pain, vomiting, clinical fluid accumulation, is the child is having some bleeds. So all these points have to be told. The warning signs have to be told to the parent. Otherwise, what level they won't realize. Okay, some they can find it out from home. The child is having abdominal pain, intense abdominal pain. You're sending the child home also, still they can come back to you. So the point to understand here is, if at all you're starting a child in the febrile phase, please start only at 1.5 ml per kg per hour. Scenario 2, 7-year-old with fever for 5 days, had headache, myalgia, rash. Child is having epigastric pain. He also had mucosal bleeds. Chronic test is positive. Here we have a child of dengue with warning signs like epigastric pain and mucosal bleeds. Do we need to admit? Yes, we need to admit all the cases of dengue with warning signs, preferable to admit or better to be admitted. What is the management? This before that, management, all these warning signs will indicate a capillary leak. Please ask urine output, fluid intake, check the capillary filling time, pulse rate, BP, and also the pulse pressure. And always admit a child with warning sign and monitor, because these children tend to progress to severe dengue. These are the investigations which confirms a capillary leak, that is hemoconcentration PCV as evidenced by a rise of more than 20% from the baseline, hypoalbuminemia less than 3.5 gram per deciliter, hypocholesterolemia less than 100. Again, all this because of the fluid leaking out, albumin goes out, cholesterol goes out, all these things because of it. chest X-ray, we see a pleural effusion. In the focus, that is the point of care ultrasound, we can find out the gallbladder wall edema. And also, please send a hemoglobin PCV platelet before rehydration and later after rehydration. But before rehydration, we have to have a baseline also. And the fluids for a child with warning sign should be started at 6 ml per kg per hour. Once the child starts improving, we can shift down the fluids to 3 ml per kg per hour or 1.5 ml per kg per hour slowly. But if the child is not improving, please shift up the fluids to 10 ml per kg per hour. All these are dependent upon our vitals, hematocrit, fluid, urine output, etc. Monitor the vitals and hematocrit every fourth hourly. Always, when so you're doing or playing with these fluids, maintain an urine output of 1 ml per kg per hour. So I repeat, in dengue with warning sign, the starting fluid is 6 ml per kg per hour. In scenario 3, we have a 4-year-old child both with fever for 5 days, headache, myalgia, rash with epistaxis and melena. When brought to OPD, child had cold, clammy skin, CFT more than 3 seconds, BP is 82 by 66, tourniquet test is positive with all the IgA, NS1 antigen, IgM and IgG positive. What is the diagnosis and management? On symptom analysis, it is suggestive of a dengue with there is bleeding manifestations are there. Along with this, what is this suggestive? Cold, clammy skin, prolonged CFT with the narrow pulse pressure. So if you minus it, how much will you get? 16 millimeters. So I told you pulse pressure should be less than 20 millimeters, suggestive of a shock. This dengue shock, then the tourniquet is positive. The analysis of this lab report, IgG positive. That itself shows there is a previous infection is there and both are positive. That is a second infection has come. The infection is less than 5 to 6 days. Both have come. So the diagnosis is a severe dengue or a dengue shock syndrome. Here we have to send more investigations. We may have to send for CBC, ESR, blood grouping, PTNR, renal function test, liver function test, blood glucose, calcium, TROP-T, TROP-I, blood gel analysis, etc., etc. Management, immediately start the child on oxygen by NRM, that is a non-rebreathing mask. Then if the child is not having, if the child is having a hypotensive shock or the child is having an absent peripheral pulse, please start the child on 20 ml per kg per hour. Monitor the child, 15 minutes, the BP starts picking up or the pulse becomes palpable, decrease the fluid to 10 ml per kg per hour. So shock without palpable pulse or a hypotensive shock, the fluid is 20, whereas the shock with the palpable pulse, the fluid is 10 ml per kg per hour. That is actually from the Thailand protocol. So now let me discuss what is this refractory shock. Refractory shock is you are given 3 boluses, still the patient is in shock. So let me show you. First, we are given a bolus of 20. Again, we are given a bolus of 20. Again, PCV remains high. You are given another bolus of 20. What happens? This is a time we have to consider giving a colloid. Colloid? Why colloid? So just I'll go to the next slide and come back to this slide a bit later. Why? Because crystalloids and colloids, if you compare, crystalloids means normal saline. So what happens there? Only 25% will 25 will remain in the intravascular space. So rest all will leak out. Whereas once you give colloids, almost 100% will remain in the intravascular space. But we have a limitation with crystalloid because they are having high chloride content. But what are the limitations with colloids? Colloids can interfere with cross-matching and coagulation. They can precipitate an acute kidney injury. They can increase. Even colloids in a case of dengue fever may leak out because of the capillary endothelial damage. That will increase the interstitial pressure more actually. Okay. And so, and once you don't think that it will, it is found not to decrease the incidence of shock. So we have to use colloids judiciously. Please don't use colloids as maintenance. So what are typical indications for colloids? That is one, we have discussed refractory shock when there are 3 boluses of normal saline, 20 ml per kg per hour given, but no improvement. Yes, you can give colloid. Then you are given 2 bolus of, but still the child is in shock and having a puffy appearance, go for colloids. And in any case of shock with signs of fluid overload, we can consider giving colloids. The preferred colloids are dextran, because it is supposedly more hyper osmolar. Many places use extra starch, which are isoosmolar. So shock with respiratory distress, it is Dextran 10 ml per kg per hour, which is a dosage recommended. But severe respiratory distress means you can give 10 ml per kg per hour of Dextran, monitor the BP every 15 minutes, and once the BP starts picking up, please give low dose furosemide 0.1 to 0.2 mg per kg. Always look, have an eye on the urine output median and urine output of 1 ml per kg per hour. Once Dextran is given, what will we expect? We'll expect that hemoconcentration will come down. So the PCV fall will be there. It should be more than 10. If the fall is not more than 10, consider that an occult bleed. So once there is an occult bleed, we are coming to the right limb of it. The PCV is low. Consider blood transfusion. So what blood and what are the indications for a blood transfusion? Once there is a clinically severe bleed, or there is a refractory shock, there is a worsening acidosis, patient is having unstable vitals with normal or low PCV, or when there is a rise in PCV of less than 20% with persistent shock, consider the diagnosis of an occult bleed and give blood transfusion, whole blood, 10 ml per kg, or we can go for packed cell, 5 ml per kg. You can also go for reconstituted blood. Then in any case of persistent shock, please think ABCD. What is ABCD? Acidosis, bleeding, calcium, and dextrose. This has to be corrected. How can you do that? Acidosis, we are more pro in correcting an acidosis in dengue. Even at a pH less than 7.3, we can give bicarb infusion of 1 ml per kg per minute. Remember, in septic shock, we were giving it only when the bicarb is less than, or pH is less than 7.15. Acidosis in dengue, we are more pro in treating with a bicarb infusion because acidosis will precipitate bleed. That is why. Bleeding, I discussed, we can give blood transfusion. Then calcium, if there is hypocalcemia, go and give calcium. We can give dextrose of 10% dextrose, that is 2 to 4 ml per kg. All this, we have to correct and or make sure it is normal. So correct the coagulopathy. If the bleeding continues, you can go and give cryoprecipitate 5 to 10 ml per kg or 0.15 units per kg. Is there any role for platelet transfusion? There is absolutely no role if the counts are less, platelet count is less than, even if it is less than 20,000. But the definite indication says platelet count less than 10,000. If there is a massive bleed that is more than 40 ml per kg in 3 hours or more than 3 ml per kg per minute, you can give platelet transfusion or before surgeries. Like normal surgeries, we require around 50,000. But neurosurgery, off the aisle and all, we may have to have a platelet count of around 1 lakh. Why are we not very interested in giving platelet transfusion? Platelets are also fluids. You give more and more platelets, more chance of fluid overload also is there. And there is a destruction of platelets because of the molecular mimicry between the platelet antigen and our NS1 antigens. That is why we are not going for a prophylactic platelet transfusions. What's the role of inotropes? The child does not respond to all the above measures. We have to consider inotropes like adrenaline if the BP is unrecordable, Dobuta if the BP is normal with poor perfusion. So what are the indications for ventilation? Ventilation is shock when the child is not responding to the fluids and the child is catecholamine refractory, consider a ventilation. Consider ventilation in children presenting with absent peripheral pulse. Why? Because they tend to go into coagulopathy faster. They tend to have pulmonary hemorrhage earlier. So because of it, we better intubate and ventilate the child with an absent peripheral pulse. Differential diagnosis includes hemorrhagic fevers, chikungunya, influenza, malaria, enteric fever, lepto, etc. Because in this season, we have to. The child may present with a dengue-like illness or somewhere or dengue-like symptoms, but it may be any one of it. So we have to have a proper diagnosis also. So in this session, till now, we have discussed about dengue classification by severity. The first part is without the warning signs, then with warning signs, and severe dengue. This is what we were discussing till now. That is our management without a case-based approach. We can group A, which is our mild cases, dengue without warning signs, which we are sending home, giving a proper advice. The dengue with warning signs and the children with comorbidities will come under group B, where we are referring in for a hospital care, where we start fluids at 6 ml per kg per hour, and the severe dengue, which requires an ICU care. So the fluids, once you are starting, this is also a summarizing this. Hypotensive shock, start O2 by NRM, start on fluids. Hypotensive shock or absent peripulse, start on 20 ml per kg per hour, shift down to 10 ml per kg per hour once the pulse is palpable. Even narrow pulse pressure also, if the pulse is palpable, go for 10 ml per kg per hour. Then shift down to 6 ml per kg per hour, to 3 and to 1.5. So any child or with presenting to you with warning signs, if the dosage is 6 ml per kg per hour. And any child just here starting fluids because of poor intake, even the child is in the febrile phase, please start the fluids at 1.5 ml per kg per hour and titrate according to the urine output. Maintain an urine output always at least 1 ml per kg per hour. A few more points. You have to always use an ideal body weight for calculating the fluid requirements in obese children. That means, suppose a child, 5-year-old child is coming with a weight of 28. Do we need to calculate the fluid for that 28 kg? No. What we should do is, we should calculate the ideal body weight for that child. A 5-year, the ideal body weight, as you all know, the formula is 2 into h plus 8. So it is 18 kg. So give the fluids according to the ideal body weight in case of obese children. And the fluid intake calculation must include both IV and also the oral intake. And very important point, preemptive fluid administration will not prevent shock in the critical phase. Because once the child is presenting to you and you just think that I will start fluid early so that the child will not go into critical phase, that is a wrong assumption. Actually, it may make the treatment difficult because you are giving fluid in the febrile phase, that itself may leak to the interstitium. Then in the critical phase, once the leak starts, this will add on to the other fluid. So more difficult will be the management of that child in the critical phase. So use fluids judiciously in case of dengue. And how can you prevent? Prevent, always avoid mosquito bites, use of insecticides or repellents, destruction of breeding sites by using larvicides such as Abate, go for ultra low volume spray, which reduces malathion. And recently a certain vaccine in the endemic areas have come to Dengvaxia a few years back. This license was used in around 14 countries, not in India. So this is in short about our dengue and the management of dengue in a case scenario based approach. So I hope the session was useful for you. Thank you so much.